We're going to talk about effective communications and techniques and tools. And so when we use that kind of terminology, please understand that many of you who own businesses and many of you who work for businesses, a lot of times there's a lot of things that are said in the field that don't get communicated to the office. And there can be huge, huge implications. And so Tim will talk about some best practices in which you can improve your communication there in the field and try not to piss people off. Make friends, find change orders in a positive, mutually beneficial way as opposed to looking for holes. So there's a process to that. Show that leader in the field that you're a team player. And so he'll talk about some elements where some best practices have been adopted over his career. We're also going to talk about daily and production reporting. Many of us have estimates when we go into a project, but sometimes we're not really mindful about doing comparisons and seeing, hey, what we budgeted for versus how we're actually looking. And if you set up these daily production goals, you'll find out that, you know, you can make adjustments a lot quicker instead of waiting till the end of the project to find out if you did good. Planning for success, understanding and influencing the critical task schedule, and ensuring that you have a very safe job site. That's very important. We're also going to talk about best ways to manage changes in conditions. There's, you know, kind of what I alluded to a second earlier. Best practices as it relates to becoming a preferred resource. Being that person that Tim has on his hip when he has a problem, he's calling you first. He'll talk about those kind of characteristics that separate other contractors from those really pristine platinum level. Did I say platinum? I sure did. I have to use an opportunity for a plug here and there. How to become an irreplaceable field commander. That is the title of our class, an executive on the job site. Many of you think that many of you work in a job site may not see your role as being an executive. We want everyone on the job site to see that there are leadership opportunities for a value and a contribution from them. Then they can impact the job, whether you're pushing a broom or you're working the schedule, or you're operating some machinery, moving materials around. We're also going to talk about project closeout and commissioning, and we're going to touch up on basic construction law and finance. A lot of the projects that Hoffman performs, as you well know, are publicly funded projects, and sometimes when you're dealing with government entities, they have monstrous requirements. And those administrative requirements and regulations are ones that you must become familiar with and adhere to. Our outcomes today, we want to identify and understand the roles of that superintendent. We want to understand and influence that master schedule, as we just described. We want best practices to manage resources and the tools to manage that information. We want best practices to maintain a safe job site. Effective communication techniques and approaches to resolve conflict, close out commissioning of the project, and construction finance and construction law. Okay, so before I introduce our instructor, I want you all to know that I've had, you know, some of you know, quite a few years working with Hoffman Construction. And I have to say that it is so pleasant to find that the same commitment that I'm used to in the office trickles down to the field. And when I first met Tim, he was a superintendent. And that's why I thought it was really important for you to know that. Now he's the president of Hoffman Structures. And to me, Tim represents the success stories that we're trying to have replicated all across this industry, all across the state, and hopefully all across the nation. So with no further ado, I want you to give a warm welcome to Tim Creamer, president of Hoffman Structures.
Okay, thanks, Dan. I'm going to, Dan asked me to tell you a little bit about my history. Like James, I started out as a carpenter, not in the union. I worked my way into the union. I work for a company called Saunders Construction. It's actually in Denver. I worked for them as a journeyman carpenter. And while I was working there, I had an opportunity. Well, I should say it this way. I met my wife, girlfriend at the time, and there was an opportunity to go to New Mexico for her to go to graduate school. And when I was leaving Denver, we were talking about it last night, actually, when I got prepared to go to New Mexico, everybody told me I was going to starve because there was no work there. When I got to Albuquerque, I was on the work list for about a day. There was this company nobody knew about called Intel, and they were going to build this big fab in Rio Rancho. So I went to work. The company happened to be Hoffman. So I worked for that company while my wife went to school. The job wrapped up. Her school finished up. And I went back to Denver. And I went back to work for Saunders Construction. And while I was working for Saunders, I had an opportunity to work in their office doing a remodel. And Dick Saunders, the gentleman that owns the company, I happened to be working outside of his office. And also Jerome Gustafson was his area superintendent. And they were just nice people to work for as I was in there working. And essentially, I came up with an idea of starting my own business and trying to be a sub to that company. So I did that for quite a while. And as things were growing and changing for me, the market changed. And when the market did change, I had to make a decision. I had to make a decision if, am I going to keep going working for myself, or, do I want to try to work on these projects like the Intels and these bigger plants and do that? And I knew one of the obstacles to doing that, if I wanted to continue to grow and maybe get into project management and be a superintendent, was I needed to get more education. So along the way, again, I'll bring my wife because most of the good ideas I've ever had came from her. We came to Seattle from Denver, and the UW actually has a program, a construction management certificate program. And I came home one day while I was working, and the information for that certificate program was on the table. My wife printed it out for me, and I went through it, and I decided to sign up. And when I signed up for it, it was an incredible program. It still is. But I went to turn in a project at one of the architecture halls, and it was a sign-up for Hoffman Construction. So I decided to sign up. I'm like, I know those guys, right? I'll sign up. And I actually got an interview with Marjorie. And when I had the interview, I think she was shocked that I was a little bit older than most of the people that were in school at the time. But, she ended up giving me a call a couple days later, and she offered me an internship. And when she told me how much it cost, I kind of laughed and said, I have a mortgage. I don't know that I can do that. So anyway, they called me back a couple days later and they said, we're kind of revamping our concrete division. And there's a project, a water treatment plant that, we're not sure what we want you to do, but we're going to have you, if you're willing to, just go out there and just do everything you can. So that was Everett Wastewater Treatment Plant. I think Trevor was actually the PM. And I just went out, and I think, one of the things that makes Hoffman a great company is that, I don't know that you're bound by any job descriptions. You just go and do everything you can. So I went out, I did everything I could there. I went from there to a couple other projects. Ended up at Brightwater, which was Dave and Trevor, I think, or a combo. That was a really big water treatment plant here in Washington. And while I was working there, I ended up having an opportunity to go to another concrete project, Procure. So I went and I was a concrete superintendent. I did that project, and then I had an opportunity to go out and do a couple interviews to actually bid work, and I think, and try to get work. And that's where I met Dan for the first time. He was part of our group that went to chase the work. Luckily enough, we were successful on that project. We went and chased another one. I was successful. As a group, we were successful on that one. And then I got a call, and someone, the gentleman that owns Hoffman, or the president of Hoffman, asked me if I'd be willing to, run their concrete division, become president of their concrete division. So I said yes, And so that's how I got my job. But the reason I wanted to tell that long story when I talked to Dan about it the other day is, you know, along the way, there was opportunities for me just to learn more. When I was a carpenter like James working outside the union, I had an opportunity to go to Penn State Ogons at night and learn how to read blueprints. Just like you guys are spending your night here trying to learn something, I was at the table just like you are trying to learn how to read blueprints. I took a couple other, you know, evening classes and things like that. When I got into the union, in Albuquerque, when I was working there, I ran into a gentleman, his name is Valentin Mayez, and one of the things that still sticks with me today was, he said, Tim, every job you go to, you need to take something from it. And so I went to school and learned how to weld at night. I became a welder while I was on that project, because I knew if I took that to the next project, maybe I could work longer. So I did that. When I had the opportunity to go back to the UW, again, it's that lifelong opportunity to learn. All those times I was doing that, I didn't know that they would somehow all tie together. But I think it's really important that you always give yourself an opportunity to keep learning. And I'm glad I see, you know, HSI guys here, because they may just hear something tonight that, you know, carries them to maybe go take a class or go do something or learn a different software that could help them schedule. So I think one of the reasons I'm really excited to be here is because, other than a couple of the folks that are in the video and the website end of the business, I think I've had everybody's job in here, you know, except for these guys. So you never know where you're going to end up. So I'll go through these, and I don't ask. If you have questions, I think it's okay just to ask as we go. So with that, I'm going to get it going. Okay. Superintendent roles and responsibilities. This is actually something that if you came to work for Hoffman Construction, this is something that I would show to people and say, these are, I would say, things that you need to focus your efforts on. So obviously long-term planning, a superintendent on the job for Hoffman Construction or Hoffman Structures is the one that's responsible for setting the pace, setting the schedule. So you need to be looking beyond the work that's getting done that day, right? You need to be looking out a couple months and making sure that you're going to have the materials and the labor that you need 2 months ahead of time while the work's happening on your project. So long-term planning is very important. You're also responsible for safety on your project. You include the project managers, you include the foreman, the engineers, and everybody on the site, the owner, the other subcontractors in safety. But really, as a superintendent, people look at you as the leader for safety. You know, you set the pace on safety, and when you talk about safety and how you act, you know, folks are watching it, and it is hugely important that the superintendent carries a torch for safety and makes sure that everybody understands that that's the most important thing that you do on the job. You know, when you're out there as a superintendent, when I was given orientations as a superintendent, one of the things that I would tell everybody, I want you to at least go home in the same shape that you came through the gate. And on good days, I'd like you to go home a little bit better. And what I always meant by that was, sometimes, man, you have a fight, you know, something at home, something that's bothering you. You know, you come to work, you get through the work day. You know, sometimes when you come out the other end, you feel better than when you came. But I certainly wanted you to make sure that, you know, you didn't get injured, you didn't get hurt, so you could continue to be able to earn a paycheck and go home and, supply that the money and things your family needs and continue that quality of life, because that's really what it's all about at the end of the day, is your family. Okay, manpower. Manpower is hugely important. Trevor and Dave you know, as they set up their budgets, you know, they're going to come to superintendents and they're going to ask you, you know, for your estimate, how many guys you're going to need, how long you think you're going to need them. You know, they're going to ask you maybe to do some things where you man load a schedule so they can kind of see the curve that's going to, you know, happen as the job ramps up and ramps down. So as a superintendent, you've got to be able to talk to your subcontractors, understand how many men it's going to take to do different parts of the project. And then you're going to have to use the experience that you have to be able to understand, you know, if somebody tells you I can do that with five guys and you've never seen anybody do it with less than 10, you know, you're going to have to ask that question. And then you're going to have to be able to make sure that people provide you with the adequate manpower. And it really is something that we'll get into a little bit later, but what's really important about the manpower is you have to monitor it as you go along so that you don't get, you know, too far. You don't want too many guys on the job where you're blowing up your budget, but you don't want to have not enough where you can't keep up with the schedule. So it's really something that you need to pay attention to. Submittals, you know, as a superintendent, you're not the guy that's actually writing up the submittal and turning in the submittal. A submittal is basically information that's required by the contract that you're bound to, that the owner wants to see, or that, you know, they could say, we would like to see your concrete mix designs. So you'd go out to a concrete supplier, you would get the mix designs, and then you would submit it officially to the owner, and the owner would look at that, their engineers would look at it, and they would give it back to you and say, okay, that's adequate, or it's not. You're not the guy that's actually writing the submittals, but you need to be able to talk to the engineers that are on your job, work with the project managers, and make sure that the submittals are keeping up with the pace of the job and things that are going to be needed, right? Not today, but the things are going to be needed in 2 weeks or 2 months. So that's a really big thing. It's the monitoring of the submittals. Daily diaries, the daily diaries, they include headcounts, weathers, deliveries. You know, if there's an accident on the job or there's an incident. So as a superintendent, again, they will come across your desk. They will say, you know, that the information will be compiled by your GF or your foreman or your subcontractors. Your office manager will get that on a daily diary. You know, if you're a small business, you're going to be doing all that yourself. But what you want to do is you want to make sure that if it says the dirt contractor had 30 guys on the site and you think it was 10, it does matter, because on some of our projects, like Dan mentioned, they have different requirements on reporting man hours and wages, and if you don't keep track of that kind of stuff, you end up having issues down the road. So it's really important that you monitor all that. Schedules, you know, as you see in a little bit when I get into the scheduling part of this, I believe that schedules are so very important to a project. If you have a good schedule that you can count on, that you as a superintendent created, you went to your subcontractors, you talked to your project manager, you know, you talked to your owner, and you build a schedule that you know will work, I always felt, once I got through the schedule and I got all that information put on the schedule and finally got it out there on the table and had the project managers, you know, look at it, approve it, the owner approves it, it's kind of a freeing experience, because at that point, you know, all right, we got a plan. Now all we have to do is follow that plan. And so when you're building your schedule, be sure that it's something that you know you can execute. And the other part of that is you have to be able to communicate your plan to the project manager, any owner, and so that they will understand it and accept it and know that you're right, or know that, you know, you're correct. Coordination meetings, you know, again, you are in a lot of ways, you're that field general. You know, you have subcontractor meetings where you're going to bring all the subcontractors in and you're going to sit there and you're going to discuss. At least on a weekly basis, you're going to discuss the schedule. You're going to discuss submittals, right? You're going to discuss any issues that are coming up, any problems that the subs might have meeting the schedule or meeting manpower or long lead items or deliveries that they might be having. And so those sub meetings, again, a lot of the time or most of the time, the project manager's there as well. But I feel that the project manager looks to the superintendent really as that person that runs the day-to-day operations in the field, that really has that connection with the subcontractor on how many guys do you have? When are you going to be done? You know, when is that equipment going to be here? You know, that's all the kind of things that you're going to communicate during the subcontractor meeting. Miscellaneous project management. I didn't know Dave and Trevor were going to be here before I put that one up there, but there is times where you get involved in things that may, you know, be something more that a project manager would do on a day-to-day basis. You know, you may need to reach out to a subcontractor's, you know, somebody in their office and ask them, ask the other project manager, you know, when are we going to get that equipment? You know, it doesn't happen a lot, but it does happen. So you have to be prepared to do, you know, a little bit of project management when you need to reach out to these subcontractors and sometimes with the owner as well. Coordinating, detailing, you know, essentially with that kind of falls more on the concrete side. But on the concrete end of things, we detail things as we build them. And as a superintendent, it's kind of like making sure you have the equipment you need 2 weeks from now or 2 months from now. You need to make sure that your detailing that you're doing today will prepare you for what you need 2 weeks from now. If you start detailing what you need for today, it's too late. So you got to monitor all those things. Oversee field operations. So again, you're the field general. You're the guy that's got to make sure that all the subs are in the right place, doing the right thing at the right time. So that's an important part of what you're going to do.
Tim, can you clarify what you mean by the coordinating with the detailing?
I can. So on the concrete end of things, as a concrete superintendent, we use 3D modeling, and we use details that we make from those 3D models to hand to the guys in the field to actually build from. We really don't build, I shouldn't say it that way. We use the construction documents, the one-dimensional drawings. We take those drawings and we create a 3D model. We use Revit and we create a 3D model. And then we use that 3D model to create detailed drawings to build from. It allows the guys in the field to not only have, for example, instead of giving, you know, Nate the entire first floor plan of a million square foot building, we would give him a chunk of it that we took from a model and we detailed, because he's not really worried about what's on the far corner of that building today. He won't get there for 3 months. He's worried about what's on this corner today. And so it allows us to kind of feed Nate the information he needs in pieces. So we take the drawings that we're given, the contract drawings, we make a model, and then we make detailed drawings. We add details to the drawings. We may show, I don't want to get too far into it, but like section cuts or details that are unclear on the regular construction documents. The project as a whole also creates a model and uses that model to coordinate all the other trades, all the MEP coordination and everything. So it's really, it's not the way the future's here. It's the way we do business. A lot of conflict resolution, and so it's really a great tool. But, you know, you, as a superintendent, you're not building that model. But again, you know, James may say, when is the piece of the model that affects this, you know, level three while he's working on level one, when is that going to be done so I can look at it and review it? You know, that's what you need to do. You need to be asking the question, when is that detailing and when is that model going to be done? Because if it's not done in time, it's going to hurt the project, and you're going to fall behind. EEO, and you know, as if there's any EEO issues on your project, you are really you are the primary contact for that on the project. So you have to be aware, and you have to be sensitive to that issue. And at Hoffman, I can tell you that we take it very seriously, and we look to that superintendent to make sure there aren't any issues on projects. And if there is projects, an issue on a project, it gets reported, and then it gets, you know, it gets to, you know, Trevor and Dave's level, and we investigate and we take care of those things. But as a superintendent, you know, you have to understand that you're the go-to person on that site. So along with all these other things, you know, you do need to understand that part of your job, and understand, you know, if you're a small business right now growing, you know, it's a kind of thing that whether you have an EEO policy at this point, you may not, but you know, those are important things to look at as you grow, and you may want to develop a policy so that when things arise, you know how to handle it. So it's a very important part of what we do. Requisition approval. I didn't know Mike was going to be here when I wrote this, but what are we ordering and when, right? It's important if you have, you know, we supply safety equipment for the men, right, and ladies that are on our job. If you have a job where you're going to average 10 people on average in a crew, don't order 200 safety vests, because when the job's over, you're going to have 150, right? So, you know, as a superintendent, I'm making jokes about Mike right now. He is a superintendent, so he understands that. You have to review the bills that are coming across and the requisitions so that, you know, if you know the guys are getting ready to build this section, or, you know somebody is going to build some handrail, let's say that, and they need a bunk of 2x4s, and you see a requisition for 10 bunks of 2x4s, you know, that's a good question to ask. What are you going to do with the other 9 bunks of 2x4s? You know, because it's important, right? It all goes back to the budget, and you know, Trevor and Dave are going to ask you why you ordered 10 bunks of 2x4s. We only have 100 feet of rail. And then invoice approval. You know, you're going to verify cost and products. You know, I know when I wasn't a superintendent on the job, every superintendent I ever worked for or project manager would walk up and say, what is this for? You know, if there was, you know, you ended up ordering, I could see for Brightwater one time, we had to order some heat tape or some of the exterior piping, because as the project developed and it wasn't 100% up and running, we had to protect the pipes that were outside, and it was spendy stuff. But you know, that's the kind of question you're going to get, like, why are you getting heat trace tape from Omaha, Nebraska? Isn't there any for sale anywhere closer? And the answer is, most of the time, no, right? Because you're trying to reach out to get what you need. So you know, it's important to verify, you know, what the guys are ordering, and you know, go up and ask the question. All right. Effective communication techniques and tools. Hoffman they rely on whiteboard meetings very heavily. Before they were called, I think the whiteboard meeting word came from working on some of the other big projects, but you know, the projects that I was on, whiteboard meetings, they either happened first thing in the morning before work started with the foreman, where you know, you get the foreman together, you get your subcontractors together, and you say, just like you're sitting here today, and say, you know, Dan, what do you got going on? You know, do you have any deliveries today? Where are you going to be working? How many guys are you going to have? Then I'd say, Casey, where are you working today? How many guys are you going to have? Do you have any deliveries? And inevitably, something's going to come up where somebody says, oh, wait a minute, I'm working in that area. And you know what? My delivery is at the same time your delivery is. And I need the crane. How am I going to use a crane if you have the crane? And instead of having that discussion in front of 300 people, you're having it in a group of 20 or 30, and you're getting through those things. So it's a great time to talk about daily goals, deliveries, complexities, high risk activities. If there's any safety issues for that day, you know, Casey may say, "Hey, I need a crane. I'm going to be flying stuff around. You can't be working underneath me." And Dan says, "Well, I'll schedule to be in there." So, you know, a lot of things come out of those meetings. We also rely on something called stretch and flex. At Hoffman, we require that all subcontractors join in with the Hoffman team, and we literally get out there and we stretch and flex every morning. Some superintendents do it to music. I was on a project with Mike down on Lake Washington, and you know, it's 6 o'clock, 6:30 in the morning, and there's, you know, 40 construction workers out there, you know, doing calisthenics in the morning, and people would walk by on the lake and try to figure what are they doing. But what we found was that when we did that, two things happened. We reduced soft tissue injuries, but something I think is even more important than that, it was a moment in time where we would go around the circle and we would say, what do you have going on today, when we got done stretching? And somebody would say, this is what I have going on. We go to the next guy, what do you have going on? It was kind of an extension of the whiteboard meeting, but every crew member was at that meeting doing the stretch and flex. So there'd be things that you might have forgot about in the whiteboard meeting, or you know, it could be as important as somebody hearing that there's going to be a delivery at 10 o'clock. So if they're working in an area where the deliveries are coming, and stretch and flex, are going to hear about it. And so it's really a good communication early in the morning to everybody that's on that team. It's really a good tool. Staff meetings, again, a lot of times the project manager will run the staff meeting, but as a superintendent, you need to be involved, you need to support the project manager, and you need to understand where the project's going. Staff meeting is going to be with engineers on the site, the Hoffman employees or the employees of your company. You want to get them together, you're going to say, hey, that's where you're going to say, hey, look, I noticed the submittals are falling behind. Or, hey, we had that long lead item, where is that? And then you're going to have meeting minutes. I think this is important. You're going to have meeting minutes so that the next week you're going to have the same conversation. You're going to say, last week we talked about this long lead item. You said it was going to be here Thursday. Did it come? And it either did or it didn't, but you make a note of it and you know to go back to it the next week. So those staff meetings are really important. It helps you organize, you know, your team. Pool phase planning is, I think, a way of scheduling. It essentially allows the construction team to develop the schedule together. The way it works is you'll set a goal or a benchmark, and then you will ask everybody, all right, who needs to go first? What's the first step in us getting to that goal? And then the next step, and the next step, and the next step, and how long is it going to take for you to get there? And then what you start to work and rework things until you can meet that goal that you set. It's something that, you know, Hoffman's going to more and more, and it has a lot of benefit because people take ownership. You know, if I make a schedule and say, James, you got to have this done by Thursday, you know, James could come in and say, I never said I could get it done by Thursday. But if James is in a meeting with me and he says, in front of 20 other guys and ladies, I can get that done on Thursday, he's more likely to get it done because he's taking ownership in it, and it's a goal that he set. So I think that, you know, at the heart of it, that's what it's about. Again, subcontractor meetings, I went through that. And then owner meetings, you know, owner meetings, that's, again, most of the time the project managers run the owner's meetings, but as a superintendent, you need to be there. You know, there's a point in time where in the meeting they're going to go over schedule. You need to know your schedule, you need to be able to go over it. You know, if there's a problem on the schedule or something that one of the project managers needs more detail, you need to be there and have the answer. So it's important to be involved in all those things.
Tim, are you doing 3-week look ahead with the owner and the subs, or who's typically looking at the look ahead?
Yeah, I would say the superintendent should be getting the look ahead schedules from the subcontractors and then compiling that information and then going through that at the owner's meeting.
And updating the critical path from that.
Yeah. Daily and production reporting. I talked a little bit about the headcount. You know, that goes to the daily diaries. But it is important to know, how many people are on your job and that, you know, the subcontractors are meeting the requirements they need, to get their activities done. The weather. You know, the weather's important. It may not be important that day. It could be important 3 months down the road when you're trying to figure out why you had a weather delay. Why did we lose the day? You know, and so it's important to note that on the daily diary. If something were to come up a year down the road and they said, well, I couldn't pour that concrete on that day because it was raining, and you go back to your daily diary and you see that it was sunny and 80 degrees, right? That's not a good excuse then, right? What really happened? So it's really important to document all those things. Claim sheets. At Hoffman, claim sheets are how, on the concrete side of things, it's how we judge where we are week by week on our estimate, on our production that we're doing. So as a concrete superintendent, it's important that you know, let's say if you had 20,000 square feet of one-sided wall form that you needed to put up, it's important that as the superintendent, you know how much of that square footage is done at that moment, at that snapshot in time. Because that's going to tell you if you are making your estimate or beating your estimate or falling behind. So it's very important to be able to make sure that the people in the field are communicating to you the quantities that are correct, so that you can show management, because management will look at those claim sheets and it gives them a snapshot of how your job is doing. Labor reports are what come from the claim sheets. So that is just a quick, it's unit-based, some historical data and productivity rates on it, but it gives folks like Trevor and Dave an opportunity to see how the project's actually doing in a snapshot. They don't have to necessarily go out to the job. They can look at this claim sheet, at this labor report for this week, and they can say, okay, they're making their units, or they're making their estimate. So it's important to be able to explain that. Does anybody want? I don't know that I explained that very well, because it's a detour from, I think, what a superintendent on the main job would do, but I think as a small business owner, right, you're trying to find every way you can to know where you are. And while, I can't share our unit-based rates or our historical data, I can just tell you that, if you figure out how much square footage you have and you figure out how many hours you had and you do some math, you can keep track pretty well on where you need to be. And so it's important.
So you're doing an estimate for a project, and what's important when you do your estimate is there's kinds of work. So let's talk about drywall, right? You have layout, right? So that you have to do X number of linear foot of wall for layout. Then you're going to be installing track, studs, right? Then you're going to be sheeting the wall. So each one of those would have a unit cost. There's a unit cost for X number of linear feet of wall that I got to lay out. I'm allowing, I've got 50 hours in my estimate to do that layout. Okay, I've got another 100 hours in my estimate to install track. I've got another, and so these are all accounts. You'd have an account structure that breaks this down. And and I've got, let's just say, I got 500 hours for putting in the metal studs, I got another 1,000 hours for hanging the rock, I got another 1,500 hours for finishing the rock, okay? So each one of those is there's a unit cost associated with that that comes from your estimate. And now what you're doing, what Tim is trying to describe, that claim sheet allows you to measure against that. So you know if your foreman is properly coding his time to the right kind of work he's doing, here's the number of hours he spent on that. How much did he actually get? That's the claim sheet. How much work did he get in place for the hours he spent? And you compare the two, or you basically do the math from that, and you can compare that against your estimated unit. And that is the thermometer or the barometer of how you're doing against how you estimated the job. You'll know if you're falling behind, you're ahead of the game, you need to adjust man-car to make sure you get back to your job. That's what it's all about.
Trevor made me think of this. You had 100 linear feet of wall to build, and you had 100 hours to build it in. And you've got 50 linear feet of that wall built, but you use 75% of your hours. Trevor's going to say, Tim, it seems like you've used 3/4 of your hours, but you're only halfway through that activity. And that's what it's going to point out.
So is that trend true, or is there something else going on? Right.
Thank you.
But it's important information. Planning for success and influencing the schedule. All right. I'm a schedule nerd. I love scheduling. I love digging into the drawings. I love digging into the specs. I love digging into all the requirements. And I love putting the schedule together. One of the things that I learned when I went to the UW was I learned how to operate scheduling software. So what that allows you to do, it allows you to take all the experience that you have building something, and all the years you watch things get built, and once you have an activity and you have a duration and you know the next activity that ties to that, software allows you to put that all together. It'll show you where you have some flaws. It'll allow you to fix it, and then it'll tell the story all the way through the job. And if you fall behind on something, you can adjust it, but that schedule is the blueprint, and it may be a blueprint for a project that's 4 years long. And you have a blueprint. You're going to have to adjust and make adjustments along the way. But if you do it correctly and you build a good schedule, it is so powerful, because if you have a good schedule and a schedule that can be made, you're going to have a successful project. So some of the things you do to make sure that you are build a good schedule. I wrote this, or Dan highlighted it after we talked. Read all the documents, specifications, general notes, RFPs, environmental reports, etc. You know, when you go through a project, you can have 1,000 pages of stuff in an RFP that they will give you to read as you're going through to build a project or build a schedule, or as these guys, they're going to build an estimate or approach to get a project. I would suggest that you read through or look at every piece of paper that you can get, because you never know what you're going to find. You know, there could be something in there that may give you an edge on getting the project. It may, on the environmental end of things, we work together chasing, again with Dan, Coleman Dock. We're getting ready to remodel Coleman Dock, the main ferry terminal downtown, right? There was pages and pages and pages of environmental concerns and requirements. You know, when can you actually work in Puget Sound? If you were to build a schedule and not include that information, your schedule's not going to work, right? So you just got to dig. You got to dig. It's like being a detective. And you know, you're going to have those aha moments where you're like, this may make the difference between us getting the project. Because when you get in front of somebody and you have to explain your schedule, you're gonna have facts, and you're gonna have a schedule that was built on facts. So it's important you dig through all those things. Look for time constraints, environmental. You know, are there public issues like on a Coleman Dock project, right? Obviously, you know, there's folks that use that There's ridership that goes through it every day. You got to be concerned as you build your schedule. Are there safety requirements? Is there certain times of the day you can't get deliveries? Things like that. You need to dig in. I talked about environmental. And then what's also important as you're digging in, you're going to look for high-risk activities. You're going to identify those high-risk activities on your schedule, and you're going to be able to reach out to your subcontractors and have them help you understand those risks and mitigate those risks. And you can do that within the schedule. You know, you can highlight areas in your schedule that are high risk so that everybody knows they're coming. And when you review your schedule, you can talk about specific safety plans that you need for that work. You got to dig into the blueprints. You know, we do live in a world where we get to 3D modeling. And but I would tell you this, as a superintendent, you need to dig into those blueprints and look at them and understand them and build your schedule from those documents. Because, again, you should be the person on the job that knows more about that project and how to build it than anybody, because you're the guy that's driving the schedule. So you need to dig into those documents. You need to dig into the blueprints. You need to reach out to subcontractors, right? You know, if you're on a project where they need to install auger cast piles and you've never been on a job where you install auger cast piles, you know, what kind of durations do you need? You know, you need to reach out to your subcontractors. Don't be bashful. Call somebody. Call your project manager. Say, who have we used to do auger cast piles in the past? You're going to look into that. You're going to reach out to subcontractors, and you're going to set durations based on their experience. So it's important that you do that. Qualified durations, right? Don't assume. It's really important that you do that. Develop schedule based on best case scenarios. I told Dan this when we were going through these things. It's really important that you develop your schedule and build your schedule. You get all this information, you put the information together, you build a schedule. Build your schedule on, or base your schedule on how you would build this building in a best case scenario. See where you come out on the other end. If you're 6 months longer than the actual duration you had to build this building, right? You fall back, you make adjustments. See where you come out. Make your adjustments, talk to your subs, adjust things, make things work. Don't build your schedule. Don't short yourself on an activity because you're trying to fit it into a certain window, right? You've got to understand what your durations are. If it means that you now have to have an activity that you had 20 days for, you need to do that in 10, that means you need probably more people and more equipment, but you know, you can develop that as you go and make sure you know what you're doing. Compared to the RFP, schedule restraints, you know, you just want to make sure that your, again, that your schedule that you build matches the RFP. If the RFP says you have 14 months to build something and your schedule is 18 months, it doesn't work. So you gotta make sure that you match that. You know, you're going to make adjustments, you're going to finalize your schedule, and then when you get to that point and you feel good about it, and that's when you're going to go to your project manager and you're going to show it to the owner. You know, that, and, but I think what's really important is that you know it's a good schedule. You know, Trevor's working at Oak Harbor right now. He's working with Brian Shirley at Oak Harbor. You know, Brian is really good at scheduling. You know, he's one of those guys that knows more about the project than anybody on the project. And it really needs to be that way if you're the superintendent. And I think what you do by getting into those drawings and the documents and everything, and you learn and you build your schedule, you know, you do become that field general on the site. And I would tell everybody here, I would find somewhere that you can get proficient using Primavera and also or Microsoft Project. It is something that if you're going to continue to grow, if you're going to get to the next step, if you're going to get on to a step beyond that, being able to take all that, all the information that you've gathered and experience that you've gathered in the field all those years, and be able to take that and now put it into a schedule, it's a big deal. You know, it allows you to communicate with Dave and Trevor. It allows you to communicate with the owner. it allows you to make adjustments to the schedule. It's a big part of, I think, how some superintendents gain success. All right, it's break. Ensuring you have a safe job site. I talked a little bit about it in scheduling. I think identify your high-risk activities. I think if you can do that, you're going to be able to look out for those activities that have high risk. You know, because it's construction, there's an element of risk to everything that we do, but there's certainly things that have higher risk. You know, like anytime, you know, you're hoisting something, you're pulling it off the ground. You know, anytime, you know, you have shoring involved, where you have that shoring that's going to be carrying a lot of weights. When you're going to be stripping activities, right? Anytime people are going to be put in a position that's going to be working with the crane, you know, these are activities. You know, excavations, deep excavations, shoring. You know, these are activities that, you know, are high risk, and if you can identify them prior to starting the activity on your schedule, you're gonna really keep people safe. Pre-construction meetings, you know, in pre-construction meetings, there's generally a pre-construction meeting where you get the subcontractors together, you go through the schedule, you know, you go through the requirements in their contract to make sure everything that's covered. Something that Hoffman's working on and implementing is pre-construction safety plan, safety meetings. That, so it's specific to safety. You know, you're going to have your subcontractors come in, and you're going to have a pre-construction meeting, but the focus will solely be on safety, not contract, you know, not materials, just safety, and how you're going to keep people safe. Project-specific safety plans from all stakeholders on Hoffman sites. Subcontractors are required to submit site-specific safety plans, and the superintendent is going to review those site-specific safety plans and make sure everything that's identified is covered. So you need to go through them. You need to understand what the risks are. You know, most of the time you'll get the site-specific safety plan. What you'll do is you'll redline it, you'll go through, you'll make some notes in it, you'll give it back to the subcontractor, you'll have them make their notes, you'll ask the questions you want to ask, and then you'll get it back. Orientation as a superintendent at Hoffman, every person that steps foot onto a Hoffman job site goes through a Hoffman orientation. They watch a video that covers a lot of our policies and procedures, and then they get to meet with the superintendent or the safety professional on the job. It's a time where you can look a guy and a lady eye to eye and talk to them, ask questions, and make sure that they understand your requirements for safety on that site. And it's also a moment where, you know, to me as a superintendent, giving orientations, it you know, safety is personal, and it's a personal, it gives you the opportunity to make sure that they understand you personally do care and you want them to go home safe every day. The actual safety video has a Spanish version. So, you know, if we think that's the situation that we're in, you know, we will have and we'll play, we will show the Spanish video.
We also have a requirement for subcontractors if they have non-English speaking employees, they need to provide someone who can translate or help communicate with those people. We only require that you have regular safety visits from your corporate safety personnel.
A lot of our documents, our safety documents, we have a job hazard analysis book that I'll show you in a little bit, but we have an English and a Spanish version inside there. So we do our best. Pre-test plans. A pre-test plan is required by every subcontractor that works on a Hoffman site. A pretest plan is essentially a blueprint of the activities that you're going to work on that day. And what it does on that sheet, it'll identify your activities, it'll identify your hazards that go along with that activity, and then you need to find out or identify how you're going to mitigate those hazards. So you have your activity, you have your hazards that are attributed to those activities, and then you have mitigation efforts to reduce the risk of that activity. Those are done daily on the Hoffman worksite. The subcontractors will do the pre-task plan. They will share it with their workers. When they share it with their workers will sign it. You know, we're not having them sign it so that, you know, we can say later, you signed this, didn't you understand it? You know, I don't know about you, but I kind of make it a rule that I don't sign things that I don't read and I don't give input on. And what I always tell everybody in orientation is that when you review that pre-task plan with your general foreman or your superintendent, it's your opportunity to give input on it. If you feel that it's not covered 100% or there's another risky activity or another hazard that's, you know, attributed to that activity, that's your time to speak up. And when you sign it, you're essentially saying that I'm part of that team, I understand it, and, you know, you're going to go out and to your best ability, you know, you're going to pull off that pre-task plan or that activity that day incident-free. Again, they're done every day. And again, they would be reviewed by the project superintendent or the safety person on the project. Job hazard analysis, otherwise known as a JHA. There's a book floating around right now. What we've done on the concrete side of things, a lot of companies do it for a lot of different parts of the business that they do or the different activities they do. But what we do, we essentially have gone through an activities that we do a lot. We basically have customized a job hazard analysis sheet, and it's essentially, it has activities, hazards, and mitigation that you will include when you're doing your pre-task plan. But on the concrete side of things, if you are, doing high shore on a deck and you're filling out your pre-test plan, you could go to that JHA and you could look under that high shore and you look at it, and there's going to be some kind of a blueprint that identifies the hazards that are identified with that and then how to, how to mitigate it. It's a tool that will help you while you're filling out your pre-test plan. It might identify, for example, like a leading edge that's noted on the JHA that you might have left out of your pre-task plan. But there's a lot of work that goes into that book, but it's a really good tool. Large group safety meetings. Large group safety meetings are something that the superintendent would run. Again, everybody on the job site, and you can say everybody on the job site, and you know, you could be working at a big project that has, you know, 1,000 people or more, right? And there's these large group safety meetings and everybody's there. You know, then there's a speaker, the superintendent gets up and talks to everybody. He identifies things that have happened on the job. He talks about ways to not have it happen again. He talks about high risk activities that are coming up. He may talk about morale. He talks about all kinds of things. But it's, again, as a superintendent, it's your moment to address everybody that's on your job site and bring up any concerns that you may have. But it's a good tool. We also have small group safety meetings or toolbox meetings. A toolbox meeting is essentially where you would take that pre-test plan that you created along with your JHA, and you're going to go out to your crews in the field, and you're going to review your pre-test plan with them, and then they'll sign it. And you'll talk about, you know, you'll talk about things you heard in the large group safety meeting. You may talk about things you heard in your whiteboard meeting. You may remind folks of things they heard in the stretch and flex. And so it's more specific to your activity as opposed to the entire project that day. You know, as a superintendent, there's not a more important job than safety. You have to, you know, you're responsible for the, you know, for the safety of the people that are coming onto your job. You know, you want them to go home safe, right? You want to be known as a superintendent with a safe project. People want to come and work for people that are safe, right? They want to know that I can go provide for my family and make a good living and come home safe. So as a superintendent, you know, you are the leader when it comes to safety. And, you know, one of the things that I kind of learned from other folks that I work for, you know, when you're having meetings, start with safety. Have a safety topic that you start your meeting with. You know, make sure everybody understands that the most important thing that you have on your job is safety. You know, those things go a long way. Best ways to manage changes in conditions. I think number one is don't panic, right? Nobody wants to see the person that's supposed to be running the project panic, right? You got to, even if you feel like panicking, don't let anybody see that you're panicking, right? You got to understand what the problem is. You got to be the cool head when things aren't going well. You know, you want to trace responsibilities. You don't want to point fingers. You want to try to find what happened, and you want to make sure that you gather all the information, and then you figure out how you're gonna deal with that change of condition. You know, consult with experts. You know, I was working on a project that we had a need to hire some experts to look at some things, and one of the experts said in a meeting he wasn't getting a lot of time to talk, and the expert said, you know the first rule of hiring an expert, and the folks said no, and he said, you hire experts to hear what they have to say. So, you know, it's important to reach out to people that might be, you know, have taken care of an issue or they know more about it than you. You know, that's why they're the expert. You know, reach out, be honest with the owner. Say, this is a problem that we have. I want you to know that I'm looking at it. We'll figure out how we're going to fix it, and then we'll move on from there. I think one thing that Hoffman is very much known for is, you know, we're going to dive in and we're going to do what it takes when we do have a changing condition, and we take care of it. And it's important for owners to know that. And as a superintendent, when there's an issue that comes up, and how you present yourself and how you present the problem and what you're going to do and the facts that you bring and the experts that you consult, you're going to make them feel either really good or really bad. So you want to make sure that you have your facts, and when they leave that room, they're like, wow, you know, we know we have this issue, but that superintendent's got it covered. So it's important that, you know, you don't panic. The other thing that's really important for down the road, you need to document what's happening when you have a change of condition, because you might be talking about this thing 2 years down the road. And so what's really important is when you do have a changing condition or something that's happening, at the time it is happening, you want to make sure you document it, because, you know, it may be, you know, some of the projects that we have are 4 years or longer, and, you know, you may be dealing with something in the first 6 months that you need to discuss 5 years after it happened. So it's just important that you document it as you're there in the moment so that folks can understand it down the road. There's a real good chance a person that's taking the documentation won't be the person that's dealing with the issue down the road. So it's just important that the documentation that you have is clear, and somebody that opens it down the road can get the information they need from it. It's a good point. Best practices to become a preferred resource. I think number one is you got to be reliable. You know, the owner, the project managers, the team has to know that you're going to be there and you're reliable. You know, that's number one. You need to be known for making good decisions. You know, nobody wants to follow somebody that's known for, you know, not making good decisions. That sounds kind of funny, but I think we've all been on, you know, different projects or different circumstances where, you know, you work with somebody that, you know, doesn't seem to be making good decisions. You know, you got to really think about and put a lot of thought into it. And when you do come up and make your decision. You know, you got to live by it, and people will count on it. And so along with your reliability and your good decision-making, you know, you're working your way to become a preferred resource. I'm reading a book right now, and we added this. Opinions are great, but opinions without facts, they just don't carry any weight. You know, if you have an opinion about something and you're going to present it to your project manager or your owner, you need to back it up with facts. So if you can do that, if you can have an opinion and you back that opinion up with facts, you're going to become even more valuable. You got to be able to admit your mistakes and take ownership, right? I mean, that's one of the, I think, toughest jobs, you know, as being a superintendent. If there is an issue or something goes wrong, you have to be able to be the guy or the lady that assumes responsibility for that. You know, you don't want to say, oh, well, you know what, that general foreman, you know what I mean, I told him not to do it. I don't, you know, you have to be a person that steps up and takes a responsibility for that, because I guarantee you if you do that, you will have people that will work for you and want to work for you in the future. And it goes the same with the owner. You don't want to walk into an owner's meeting and it's always, you know, somebody else's fault. You know, you have to be able to understand when you did make a mistake and take ownership in it and come up with a solution. I talked about this a little bit earlier. You know, commit to being a lifelong learner. You know, you never know when something that you learn along the way is going to become relevant in your life. So, you know, I would just say, you know, just commit to being a lifelong learner. You know, it doesn't mean, I think what it does mean is just that, you know, look for things like this class where you can go to it and grow a little bit. You know, look for a scheduling class somewhere you can take. You know, maybe I went to a tunneling course a couple years back in Colorado. I don't know that I'll ever work on a project that they do tunneling, but it's interesting to go sit through, right? And you learn things that you never thought you would. So it's just important that, you know, you commit to being a lifelong learner, because you don't know if something that, you know, you learn today, you might use 10 years from now. So I'm just going to tell you, if one thing you remember from this class, please remember that. Commit to being a lifelong learner. And then accountability. You know, you can delegate a lot of your responsibilities as far as the workload goes, but you can't delegate the ultimate responsibility of being responsible. So, you know, you have to hold yourself accountable. And I think by being accountable yourself, it allows your team to be accountable as well. Project closeout and commissioning. This was something that when I initially looked at, I didn't think I was going to have a whole lot of input. But as you can see, I came up with a lot of bullet points. I just kind of relived it. I relived one of my projects and decided to write some things down. I think, does everybody understand what project closeout is? You know, at some point, you get to a point where you're nearing substantial completion on the project, and the project goes from a point where you're building the building to now, more than likely, the building is operating as it was designed, and now you're trying to close it out. You're trying to get the closeout documents down. It's the project manager's, you know, really involved in this part of the deal. But as a superintendent, you know, you're still on the job site and you're still involved in the closeout. I think it's important that you understand the difference between substantial completion, and final completion. Substantial completion and final completion. You know, lots of times it's literally in the spec what that means. And as a superintendent, it's important that you know what that is. If it's not clear in the spec, it's good to talk to folks like Trevor and the project manager and understand what substantial completion means and what final completion means and how you get to those. Because many times liquidated damages are tied to, or penalties are tied to, substantial completion and final completion. So it's really important that you understand what substantial completion is and that you can reach that threshold or you can reach that milestone so that you don't, you know, incur liquidated damages. Commissioning starts in pre-construction. I learned that just, you know, from working on water treatment plants with Hoffman and some combined sewer overflow projects. The most important part of a water treatment plant project is really the commissioning and having it function like it was designed. It, you know, it's the same with these combined sewer overflow projects. The most important part of that project, it all comes down to how they, or that they operate as a design. So it's really important that, you know, as you're building a schedule, like for a water treatment plant or a CSO project or something of that nature, that you really understand if this project has to be commissioned in April of 2018, you better make sure that your schedule allows you to get there. And I think something I've learned along the way from watching, you know, some of the other Hoffman superintendents on some of these water treatment plants and then just being involved in the sewer overflow projects, it's really, it's beneficial to start at the end and work your way back. Develop a commissioning plan at Hoffman. We have people, we have commissioning experts that work for us. They're a great resource. You know, as a superintendent, I leaned on that expert to help us develop a commissioning plan. You know, when does this pump go on? When does that pump go on? When do we need this? When do we need that? It's important because to lean on those experts and develop a commissioning plan. A lot of the larger infrastructure projects, you know, you need to submit that commissioning plan to the owner. And then the owner will go through it. They'll have their own experts go through it. And then, you know, it'll come back with red lines until you get to a commissioning plan that everybody can agree to. But again, you want to do that early on in construction so you understand exactly what the steps are going to be at the end to be able to get there. I mentioned working your schedule backwards. Some of the things you need to look at when you are looking at your commissioning plan, you're looking at the end, you know, you're gonna identify long lead items. You know, some of these water treatment plants that Hoffman builds, you know, have pumps that aren't sitting on a shelf somewhere, right? These things are special order that, you know, could take, you know, 6-8 months to build. Some things generators could take these days, you know, 12 months to build, right? So if, you know, if 6 months into the job, you order it, and you need it in 6 months, but there's no way to get it sooner. So you got to identify those long lead items, you know, as you're developing your commissioning plan. This is something I learned the hard way, right? Startup checklist. Mandatory startup testing required by manufacturers before the owner allows you to start commissioning or start your testing. You need a guy to be here next week that builds a pump in Milwaukee. You call him on the phone and say, hey, I need you here next week. He's going to say, I'll see you in 4 months. I'm booked. Right? You got to prepare for those things and know that if there's a certain specific piece of equipment that you have that requires a startup by the manufacturer before it goes online or before you can start the commissioning process, you got to make sure you get those guys online. So it's important things like that.
Let's take something basic like a house, okay? There's equipment in that house. You've got a furnace, right? You've got a hot water heater. You've got some light fixtures. You've got some plumbing fixtures. You might have some other fan systems, right? The commissioning is basically the checkout of those individual pieces of equipment. Once they've been hooked up with whatever the utility is, whether it's gas or electric, and they've been connected to whatever they're distributing to, for instance, ductwork for a furnace or the hot water piping for a hot water heater, or maybe it's the plumbing to sinks. The commissioning process is going through the checks as requested by the manufacturer or as requested by the owner, to ensure that functions properly and has been properly installed prior to being put into use. So commissioning is a big bubble that goes around all of that activity. that make sense? So you can have a situation where until a project is commissioned, or you then the pre-commissioning of that equipment where it's ready for the owner's use, they won't declare your project substantially complete. And if you don't hit substantial completion by the milestone that they've set in the contract, they could charge you what's called liquidated damages or a financial penalty.
Or it could impact your progress payment.
Yeah, or progress
payment. Or your retention, right?
Right, yeah. So, right, exactly. Okay.
And then the last thing we had on the list was spare parts. Again, you know, a lot of times you need to have, when you at the end of the project, there's a certain amount of spare parts that are required that you hand over to the owner. And so, again, let's say you needed two of a certain pump, and at the end of the day, you had one, and you call the manufacturer, or let's say one didn't work, you use your backup to get the plant up and running, and now you need another one, and another one takes 8 weeks to get, right? It's just all these things that, as a superintendent, you got to work with your project manager and kind of just look for these things that are going to bite you down the road. I am not a lawyer, and Dan asked me to do this slide. I said that I would do it. I would give you how I look at these things as a superintendent. This is a superintendent class. You know, what do you need to know, and kind of how do you get involved in these things on the project? You know, as a superintendent, it's important that you read through the contracts of your subcontractors, right? You need to know what they've signed on to do, right? They need to know what they've estimated. You need to know, what they owe you. You know, you want to make sure when you talk to them that you're not asking them for more than they owe you by the contract. And reading through the contract, there's exclusions and there's inclusions, right? You can read through the inclusions and see if there's something listed there that, you know, the subcontractor owes you. And then you can see where they've excluded things. And it's good to know that as your superintendent, just to read through and become familiar with that. The other thing I think that's important is, you know, when you're reading through the contracts and you're looking for exclusions and exclusions, you know, you work with your project manager and just make sure that everything that you needed to be covered in that contract is in there, and make sure that however they responded to that RFP, that everything that they've responded to or the expectations are in the contract that you have. So as a superintendent, you need to read through that and you need to know it. You know, and the project manager is certainly going to know a lot more about that than you, but it's good to be familiar with it as a superintendent. Understand the project budget and review often with the project manager. As a superintendent, you're responsible for day-to-day operations on the site. The project manager is watching and taking care of the financial aspects of it, but you have to support them on that. You have to understand if the project manager, like we talked about, the productivity rates, unit rates. It's important that if Trevor were to call and say, Tim, it seems like you've used too many hours for as much of the work as you got done. You need to have an answer. You need to know why that is. You know, you need to say, you know, Trevor, on this particular activity, really, there was more work in the first half than there is in the second half. And I feel confident that I know we've used 3/4 of the hours to get 50% done, but the remaining 25% of those hours will get me there. And so you got to know. You got to be able to answer questions that these project managers are going to ask you about the budget. I think it's also important, you know, that you look out for subcontractors and suppliers struggling financially on your job. You know, I can't give you specific examples of necessarily what you'll see. You know, somebody may come to you and say, you know, can I get an early payment, or, you know, something along those lines. You know, those are the kind of things that, you know, you got to refer those folks to your project manager. You just want to keep an eye out for things that are unusual, right? If you have a project that you have that you're running, the last thing you want is for a subcontractor on that job to not be successful or to have issues where they can't finish the job. So again, as a superintendent, you're not a lawyer, and you know, you're not there to tell people what the law is, but you are there to keep an eye on everything. And you want to make sure that if you think you see somebody maybe struggling, that you bring it up to your project manager and at least have a discussion. Because you don't want to go 6 months down the road and then Trevor says, man, I never saw that coming. And you go, well, I kind of saw a couple things. Maybe I should have said something. You want to make sure that, you know, you're giving them every opportunity. That last point was Dan's, I think, that you had put up there.
Sure. On all the projects that you are on, the owners may be made up of multiple agencies, multiple owners, multiple funding sources. If one of those funding sources is a government agency, then it behooves you to be familiar with the relevant rules and regulations that, you know, kind of cover that area. In this case, we have identified the revised code of Washington, commonly known as RCWs. That's basically the state law that pertains to contracting, procurement, and all other areas within construction law and other laws within the state. And also the CFRs, and that's a federal. And sometimes some of these projects will actually receive federal funding. And so you'll want to actually be aware of the regulations and the requirements, because they could have some conflict language that maybe your surety, maybe your bank, maybe your union organization. You just want to make sure that you're familiar, and if there's going to be an extra cost, you want to make sure that that's also included in your scope.
Thanks, Dan. How to become an executive on the job site? I think, you know, apply lessons learned and best practices. You know, you just need to use your experiences that you've gained along the way. Identify a staff member that possesses strengths you don't possess. You want to empower people to be able to do their job. You want to look for people that have strengths. Maybe somebody is a better scheduler than you are. You know, maybe somebody is better with the subcontractors than you are. You know, you've got to be able to say, maybe you could go deal with this subcontractor. It seems like you have a better rapport with them and you get a better outcome. So, you know, look for those things and people that are working with you so that you can get the best outcome. Acquire the appropriate technology to excel. You know, I mentioned 3D modeling, the scheduling softwares, there's estimating softwares, there's estimating tools. You know, I think, get proficient with those things. Track all historical data. If you haven't started, you should, right? If you're a person that finishes basements, right? You may not know exactly what your costs are going to be on the first basement, but I would say pretty much by the time you get to the fifth one, you're going to start to develop some cost. You're going to start to develop some historical data, and it'll help you understand what the costs are going to be from the fifth one on. So don't lose track of that data. Try to somehow track it so that you understand, you know, what a square foot of something cost you to do. How many hours did it take you to put up that many sheets of plywood? Those are all things that become really important down the road and help you know that your estimate's good. Maintain active communications with resource providers. Reach out to folks like Dan who are involved in things like this. We get involved in a lot of trade development organizations that kind of give people a head start to get into the unions. You want to reach out to those kind of organizations and let them know that, you know, you want to be a partner in the community and that you want to develop with them. And just, you know, one of the reasons I'm here tonight is because I know some of the folks actually from Hoffman Jobs. Some folks I don't know yet. But, you know, I'd love for someday you walk up to a job that I'm on walking through and say, hey, hi, I remember when you came and you gave that class and we had that great Thai food. You know, that's why we're here. So, rely on those resources that are out there that you have access to. You're already doing that because you're at this meeting, but, just keep doing it.
All right. Well, first of all, let's hear a warm thank you. We covered a whole lot of different elements, and I think they're going to be very valuable, and I'm so pleased that we have captured it on video. Again, at the conclusion of our class, you can go to EIW Contractor University, and you will find this and other classes. But before we conclude, we are actually very privileged to have one of Hoffman's project managers here, Trevor Theis, who's going to be able to give us some information on one of their mega projects that they've secured with Sound Transit. So with no further ado, let's give a warm welcome to Trevor.
So I know it's getting late. This is just a quick plug. This is the Sound Transit Northlink project takes Sound Transit from the University of Washington Stadium all the way up to Northgate. Along that line, there are three stations, one in the U District at 43rd and Brooklyn, which is this project that I'm going to talk about here quickly. The next one is called N150, or the Roosevelt Station. It's up on 65th and Roosevelt. And then the final one is up at Northgate itself. The train comes out of the ground up at Maple Leaf and then has the final station up there. So those three stations make up what's called Northlink. And Northlink opens up in 2021. I'm going to talk about just the one station, which is the one that we start next year, N140. This is the one at Brooklyn in Northeast 43rd. So if you know where University of Washington Tower is, the big W on there, I'm a cougar myself, but I respect the landscape. So if you know where University Tower is, it's right across the street. Right now it's a big hole in the ground. The hole is actually generated or developed by another contractor, the N125 contractor, the tunneling contractor. And the tunnel work is nearing completion. Our contract value in total, it's a GCCM contract, as many of the contracts we do are, it's about $140 million. The construction will start in May. They're telling us that we will have site access May 2nd of 2017. And our major bid package advertisements will start this November. I look to basically get bids for almost all of the work. With the bids being received in December, I know it's the Merry Christmas, everybody, but we do have a bid phase. It's during the holidays. It seems like every year I get stuck into this kind of a particular issue. But the project's substantial completion, and when we talk about liquidated damages and everything, that's an important date here, is November of 2019. And the train starts service in 2021, which includes this station. We're the last one of the three stations that will be developed, so we're on the critical path. We'll talk about that sometime when we have a scheduling class. So this shows you kind of where we're at. This is UW Tower right here. 45th, Northeast 45th on the left, so north is to the left. And I put a box around the hole in the ground. It's kind of hard for you to see, perhaps. There's a whole bunch of... I'm sorry?
You got a poker in there.
I got a poker in here somewhere. This little guy? There it is. So here's the box around the station. Well, if you look here, there's all these little... These are 42-inch pipe braces that cross the hole that brace the excavation. We have to build the station through that. So I kind of refer to it as building a building through a drain grate. And but we're going to get there, and it's going to be a beautiful station when it's all done. Our small business participation goals are 10% for small business, 8% disadvantaged business enterprises. So we're starting our heavy duty outreach sessions now with apprenticeship participation goals, 20% of total craft hours, 33% of that women or minority. We're going to have about 23 bid packages in total that come out in that set of documents that go out in November. And the value range of those individual bid items goes everywhere from down to $2,000 up to $30 million, $30 million being the concrete.
and I run the next step. So I just want to give a quick plug on that. I'm also working a project up in Oak Harbor for the city of Oak Harbor. It's a wastewater facility, and we've got some bid packages coming out on that as well. I just don't have any slides for that. If you're interested in going to Whidbey Island. Dan, back to you. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. And just to elaborate on that, we have had some pretty good success using our firms for the temporary connections, as well as some of the supporting activities. And so your assistance in coordinating those contacts would be very helpful, Trevor. Thank you so much. All right, I'm going to keep it going fast, and we're going to get out of here. All right, so again, next steps, we are going to review the class materials, which our hope is, bless you, and all those best practices. You're going to share the materials with staff and executives who were not here today. Be sure to share that with them. If you need the PowerPoint, just email me, and I'll send it to you as a PDF. They are big. It's a 1 megabyte file. As you can see, this PowerPoint is pretty substantial. Review your internal systems and be sure that they meet those standards and requirements that you learned about in this course. Communicate with one or more of subject matter experts and see if there is some technical or professional assistance that could be useful for you or your organization. Share contact information with with class participants. Make sure that you got these guys' contact information, because it sounds like they are just a fountain of information and opportunities. And finally, go to your YouTube EIW Contractor University station to see this and other classes that we've done. I want to thank you very much for making time for us today. This is my contact information, and thank you very much. Please get home safely to your families.
Thank you so much.